Hello and a warm welcome to the Christmas present specials with me, yours truly, the first in this specials for 2022. I'm going to take you back a couple of decades. Can you remember Big Brother 7? Take a look at who I've managed to grab for an interview. I have a handsome young man on the line. He is an English television personality, actor and musician who rose to fame after winning the seventh series of the Channel 4 reality series Big Brother in 2006. He has Tourette's syndrome, which we'll talk about later on in the programme. Please make some noise, viewers, as I welcome Big Brother 7 winner Pete Bennett on The Key Secret Life. Hello, Pete.
Hey, how are you doing?
How are you? Oh, I'm fine. How are you?
I'm an old man.
You're an old man. Well, you're only 40, aren't you?
Yeah, I know.
That's not old. I'm 35, and I'm catching up, but I'm not old yet.
Yeah, you don't sound old. You sound quite young. You have a very high voice.
A lot of people say that.
I'm high too. I'm in my old age. Hello, look at me.
Look at you, you're Sandra D.
Sophie's Farley can be involved.
Well, thank you for coming on, Pete, and I appreciate your spare time to talk to me. So, you've had a busy day today, have you?
You what?
Have you had a busy day?
Well, I got up at 8:30, so yeah, I reckon.
Are you doing your Christmas shopping?
No, it's too early for that. No Christmas shopping.
Yeah, a lot of people started early just to get it out of the way and done with.
Halloween, isn't it?
What were you saying, sorry?
Hey?
What did you say there?
I said it's still Halloween, isn't it?
Halloween, that's gone past now. It was only on the bloody 31st of October.
Oh, was it? Oh, fucking hell. Well, I'll take my costume off then. It might put me out. I thought I was getting funny looks.
You look a younger version of, Johnny Rotten off the Sex Pistols.
That's not very nice, is it?
And a younger version, I said, you're better looking, that's what I mean.
Well, yeah, I know. He was never the best looking guy in the world, but I do like his music.
Yes. Okay, Pete, yeah. Let's take you back to 2006. You were selected as one of the original 14 housemates for the seventh series of Big Brother. Tell us about Big Brother when you applied for it, and what made you want to apply?
It was basically to raise awareness of Tourette syndrome, which is the main objective, obviously. Because it was a bit of an unknown disease at the time. I wouldn't say it was a disease, more of a condition. But anyway, not many people knew about it, and I needed to raise the awareness so I could live happily ever after without getting started all the time.
Yeah, because it's something that you can't, cure, but it's how you learn to live with it, isn't it?
I don't know if you ever really learn to live with it. You've got to deal with it, to be honest.
A friend of mine's got Tourette's.
Oh, all right. Oh,
right,
him, yeah.
Oh,
is he all right?
Yeah, he's fine. Obviously, I'll send this interview to him, so, is that we're acknowledging him, and obviously, we'll...
He won't mind. What's his name?
His name's... I'm sure you'll be delighted. His name's Luca. He's actually a transgender... transgender drag king, I believe, but he's in a wheelchair. Yeah. Very, very intelligent lad.
He's got Tourette's as well?
Yes.
Drag queen and in a wheelchair.
Yes.
Wow. He's got his whole shebang, isn't he?
So, hello, Luca, if you're listening. I've got Pete Bennett on the line here, who also has...
All right, how you doing? How you doing, everyone? All right, how you doing? Yeah. This is my voice. Hello, how are you? Nice to see you.
It's nice to see you, to see you nice, is what Brucey would say, nice.
Hello, everyone. How you doing, everyone?
Right. Pete, I am not Davina McCall. So you can, we're not live on Channel 4, so you can swear as much as you fucking want.
Good. Cunt flexed.
What was she like to talk to?
She was alright, yeah. She was alright. It was a very exciting time being on the winner's chair, to be honest. speaking to Davina. Yeah, it was great. A great privilege. Now, I think that was the last time she ever did speak to me. I don't recall her ever really speaking to me after that. So, you know, it was it was a moment that I'll cherish forever.
Oh, yes, because
she didn't fucking speak to me afterwards, I'll tell you that much.
Yeah, because the memories, you know, when you win Big Brother, you know, it doesn't die away. They'll always live with you forever, doesn't it?
Because, yeah, it does. It does. It stays with me forever. And, yeah, I'll always remember it. And it's a shame that, it feels like yesterday. And all that excitement that I felt still lingers on, you know.
Good. That's the main thing.
But it's not that exciting now, so.
Oh, I didn't say that.
I do miss it sometimes, you know.
Yeah, I think a lot of people miss Big Brother. Glyn Wise, who was the runner-up behind you on Big Brother 7, is now working as a priest, from what I hear.
Glyn's one of my best mates.
Oh, you still keep in touch with him, do you?
Yeah. Glyn's great. I saw him recently. If you look on TikTok, my TikTok, there's me and Glyn dancing together, doing an old dance we used to do. He came and visit me, and we went to the beach together, went on the rides on the pier, and we had a great time.
Hey, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana. Here I come, man, I wanna go home. Hey, pizza day, pizza day, pizza day. Come, man, I wanna go home.
Yeah.
Good, good, good.
And it's funny because his song is like, I'm cooking an egg for a very first time out. But it's funny because he actually looks like an egg now.
Yes, he's lost his hair, hasn't he?
Yeah. How ironic.
How ironic. I thought, God, can it be Glyn? Surely. Because obviously.
Oh, I just want to dunk a soldier in his forehead.
Dunk a what, sorry?
Dunk a soldier. You know, when you were little, you got eggs and soldiers. I just want to toast some bread and dunk a
soldier. Oh, yes, yes. Yeah, I dunk an egg. Yes, eat God, hey.
Dunk some soldiers in his head because he's got great big egghead now. He's one of my best mates. I love him.
He's one of your best mates, that's the main thing.
Yeah, I love Glyn. I'll always love Glyn. And we've got a bit of a bromance, let's put it that way.
Uh-huh. Good. Yeah. Now, the big question is, obviously we've talked about Tourette's. As all of you know, you have the syndrome. The Tourette Syndrome Association initially at the time expressed some concern that people like yourself with Tourette's would be mocked on Big Brother. But, as I say, you had a lot of supporters, didn't you?
No, yeah, of course. Yeah, a lot of people supported me instead of mocking me. I think that's what the whole thing was about, you know. I mean, to be honest, though, I think it made people understand Tourette's more, and I think people still do mock it, you know, because it is actually quite a funny illness, isn't it? I mean, it does get a lot of it's kind of, out of all the illnesses you get, it's the only one you can really laugh at and get away with, you know. But it made people laugh with us instead of at us in the same way. So it's kind of, yeah. I mean, there was lots of support instead of getting badly mocked, you know. People did it because it was cool, you know. They'd pretend to have Tourette's because it was a cool thing to do. I mean, all the kids did it in school, didn't they?
Yeah, they used to say, I've got Tourette's, I can't help it, but yeah.
And they called the teachers a wanker and they get away with it, and everyone thought they were great, you know. But, you know, I think it'll always be quite a hilarious. I mean, that's the only way I've ever had to deal with it. The only way I've ever dealt with my own Tourette's is to make it something to laugh at. I've actually, you know, I laugh at myself all the time when I'm twitching, you know what I mean? And I find it quite funny.
You sound like you're coping with it really well.
Yeah, I do cope with it well, you know. On a good day, it's all right. On a bad day, it's pretty shit, and I get a bit stressed out, you know. But, you know, as I'm older, it's calmed down a lot, but sometimes I get really bad, you know.
So, out of curiosity, you know, like when you said you get stressed out, so what do you do to, have you got, like, any techniques in place, like coping mechanisms?
Fucking hell, not really. It's just got to twitch. When I'm really stressed out, I just have to twitch them out, you know. I've got to twitch as much as I can until
hit myself quite hard. You know, that's the way it relieves the stress. Because, like, in a way, pain, when I hit myself, the pain releases an endorphin in my head, and it will release a sort of calming effect on me. And it's a weird, it's a weird way, but it actually works, you know. It's a funny illness.
Have you tried a stress ball?
Have I what?
Have you tried a stress ball where you squeeze it so tight?
No.
No, that's really
no,
good.
That wouldn't work. That would not work, no.
Not for you.
You have to twitch. You have to do the twitches that your body wants you to do.
Ah, right. So obviously the twitching's probably the best way to do it.
Yeah, stress ball, no, it won't work, no. I mean, I could try having a wank.
Trust you to come out with that. Yes, I know.
Probably one of the only real stress meaning things I can do.
I'll have to keep that in. Wait till the viewers hear it.
I'm just being honest.
Oh, well, honesty is the best policy, is what they say.
Yeah, exactly.
Your autobiography, Pete, My Story, was published in hardback in November 2006. Tell us about that, because you had loads of friends of mine that bought your book and found it very interesting.
Well, yeah, apparently, yeah, I've got a lot of people saying it was one of the best books they've ever read, and I'm like, really? Well, that's amazing, I don't know why, but, I didn't read it because, I found it quite predictable, I knew what was going to happen and everything, every single word, and I was like, it was just so predictable. I thought, I know what's going to happen. So I thought, fuck it, I'm not going to read that.
How long did it take to write?
It actually took about a couple of weeks, maybe a week and a bit or something like that.
Bloody hell, you must be a fast thinker as well as a fast writer.
Yeah, I did get help. I didn't just write it by myself.
Oh, you had like people giving you ideas, etc.
No. I had a ghostwriter. So I sit there and I'm chatting about my life and he's writing it down for me. So I'm not great at writing not down on, because as I've got Tourette. So I think it would have been difficult for me to write to write some of that. And I've got ADHD as well. I'll be all over the shop. So
attention deficit hyperactivity disorder.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, you're actually the very first person with Tourette I've ever interviewed on the case, so I just want to say it's an absolute privilege to do so.
That's all right, no worries. It's great, isn't it?
It is, because you're getting the message out there, and that's what it's all about.
Yeah, Tourette's is great. Look at me. Oh my God, what was that? Did you have a twitch?
No, well, I had like a little butterfly feeling, yeah. I just think it's quite, it's just really nice to hear from somebody with the condition who's like, dead down to earth, etc.
All right. Well, I wouldn't go that far. I'm just great,
Stupid bugger. You as well appeared on the Jeremy Kyle show. You talked about being homeless, battling drug issues, but you managed to climb back up the ladder to recovery. And it sounds like it was not an easy climb, but with support, you managed to triumph through, didn't you? Because I know losing one of the most important women in your life was Nikki Graham, who sadly died. And that was a tough time for you, wasn't it?
Oh, that was terrible. And it's still to this day, very, very sore subject, to even go there, it's something that I've had to really, get my head around that one. It's not been easy ever since, to be honest. So we always stayed in contact with each other and we met up a couple of times in Brighton and went to festivals sometimes, and then we didn't see her for a few years because she went to France.
Yeah. And what was that motto she used to say? Was it, who is she?
Yeah, that's one. Yeah, it's Nikki Graham, isn't it? Yeah, but yeah, death was a really traumatizing. Because after I hadn't seen her for so long, when I saw her again, she looked completely different because she was so ill, and it really was quite traumatic. And then when I put all my efforts in to try and keep her going and keep her spirits up and that and. Save her and reconnect and she died, and it really broke my heart. I was really gutted. And then Imogen Thomas became quite a a demon. I don't even know how to describe that woman, but you know what I mean. She was putting out in the press all these horrible things about me.
And it was really
traumatic, you know.
I was just about to ask you, Imit, because obviously, you know, because you felt, because you both never spoke, have you, Sam? And you've never attempted to make amends or anything?
What with Imogen? No way. She has literally burnt every single bridge of mine. I don't think I even had a bridge in the first place. I've never really liked that woman. I know her game, and I know how fake and conniving and calculating she is. I mean, I lived with her for the last 3.5 months in Big Brother. I know that woman, and I know what game she was playing. And to be honest, I think she was jealous that she was not getting as much press as I was at the time. Nikki Graham died, so she tried to make.
So she was trying to shit stir and that type of thing.
Yeah, she tried to shit all over me, and you know that's the way it is. And she's sort of shit out of it, basically, you know what I mean?
Well, as long as she's moving on with her life and you're moving on with yours, you just kind of go wrong.
I mean, I tried to do my best for Nikki Graham, and then I got shat on by Imogen, and, you know, it was horrible. Anyway, I said no to the documentary. I thought I was far too heartbroken and hurt
at
the time to go on. I couldn't deal with it anymore, you know what I mean? I just kept away from it all. I just tried to heal. I go to therapy now, I'll get myself sorted out.
Yeah, that's the way forward. Well, you've got to put yourself first.
Therapy's great. I love therapy. It's great. All the worst things that really bug you, go and chat to your therapist and you feel a bit better. You know, it's nice, isn't it?
To talk to somebody, like talk to a stranger about what's on your mind and, you know, your worries, etc.
It's all the things you can't really speak to anyone about that really, you know.
No, because obviously that's people's business. But obviously, if you,
I love that. So anyone out there who's having a hard time, seek therapy. It's fucking great. Sorts you right out. It really does.
Let's talk about Gemma Costin, the now former Mrs. Pete Bennett, now your ex-wife. She's still an important friend in your life, isn't she?
Oh yeah. I haven't seen her for a while. She's moved away, but. Yeah, she's important, yeah.
So how did you meet Gemma? How did you meet her?
I met her, I can't remember. I think I might have met her at a fetish night, to be honest.
Is that like a sex party or something?
Right. No, we had a few, we did fancy each other, but no, it's a long story. You'll have to read my book to actually find out.
To find out the details, etc.
Yeah, it's one of the goths of me and Gemma. Yeah, check out my book and how we got
to. I certainly will. Tell me about the time you were the lead singer in a band called Daddy Fantastic.
Oh my God! My best friend, Wobbly Bob, he's...
I never knew you sang, by the way, also.
Wankers! What, that?
I never knew you sung. Until I read online.
I'm in a band called Love Dogs now. Just one word, Love Dogs, and you know, it with a Z at the end. But Daddy Fantastic was my first time ever fronting a band. My best friend Wobbly Bob, who sadly died of cancer after I left Big Brother.
Yeah.
At the same time, Jay Goody was dying. It was horrible. Really fucked me up. But he actually got me started on being a frontman to his band, Daddy Fantastic. And he had a song called Daddy Fantastic. He went, "'Cause I'm Daddy Fantastic, elastic, and if you be kind, I'll blow your mind. The results will be quite psychastic. Wow!" Anyway, I had that band for a while, but before Big Brother, you see.
Yes.
And we were a psychedelic rock and roll band, and he made me the character Daddy Fantastic, and I used to sing his songs on stage. After Big Brother, Guy Chambers approached me, and he wanted to write songs with me. Guy Chambers is the guy who wrote Robbie Williams' songs, and he wanted to collaborate with me to write some new songs, make me into a pop star.
Yes.
But the thing is, though, I had to leave Daddy Fantastic to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't want to, but my mum thought it was an amazing opportunity to work with Guy Chambers and make some songs and get out there. So I had a lot of pressure on me, and in the end, I did leave Bloody Fantastic, which really broke my heart as well. I broke, you know, Rob's heart, but I had to try and, you know, go for this thing.
The new approach.
The opportunity of a lifetime, you know. Anyway, we wrote some songs.
You did?
And,
oh, yeah.
I called myself... we Pete Bennett and the Love Dogs. That was the band that we came up with. And I didn't get a deal, obviously, because apparently Guy Chambers was asking for too much money. And it didn't happen.
Yeah.
Like $3 million deal.
Oh, God, that's a lot of money.
No one wanted to do it. It was too much money. That's what I heard, anyway.
Now, from what I hear, you set up your own cleaning business called Celebra Clean in 2016. Are you still doing that business?
No. No. You know, it was funny. I started cleaning, you know what I mean? And then every time I went round someone's house to clean their house, they were really surprised that it was Pete coming in their house and cleaning. You know, I just got a job as a cleaner for a bit, and... In the end, because it was such a fun, everyone was so shocked that I was in their house cleaning, we thought of an idea. Why don't we start up something called Celebrity Clean, where a celebrity comes around and cleans your house? So we set it up as Celebrity Clean and said, hey, get Pete to come and clean your house. And then we started getting like loads of people asking me to come and clean their house, called it Celebrity Clean. And it was great. And what I wanted to do is expand it and try and get as many celebrities as I can on the books to come and clean people's houses.
Yeah.
And none of the bastards are up for it. They were just, you know, But I thought it would be a really good idea. Imagine getting a cleaner around your house where you can choose, like, you know, maybe Mike Tyson or something. Yeah, let's get Mike Tyson to come around and clean your house. I mean, but it's just a ridiculous idea. And then next thing you know, the fucking TV company got really interested in the idea. We went to Prime Recordings. I can't remember the fucking name. Anyway, it's in London, right? And we're there having a meeting about this show that they're going to make. I think they're the same guys who made Geordie Shore. And they wanted to make this TV show called Celebrity Clean, where celebs go and clean people's houses. And it was all this really big, exciting thing that happened just because I became a cleaner. And then we made the whole thing, and then the old idea, had the meeting, and then we went, after the meeting, we went off and we got back to work, and we were waiting for them to come back and start filming, but they never did. They just fucking, apparently, those two guys who had, you know, they just left, they left. So,
yeah, without telling you.
Celebrity Clean did not happen, but that would have been a sick show. I was so close to having my own TV show then.
Oh, yeah, bloody hell. Well, speaking of television, tell us about the Nan movie, because you, obviously, earlier this year, working with Catherine Tate, who created that famous role, and I know as well, Pete, it was postponed due to the COVID-19 pandemic as well, but tell us about the Nan movie.
Well, the thing is about Nan movie is that I'm not in it, because I got cut out, and the thing is...
Yeah, joking.
I mean, the greatest thing about it was just literally auditioning and meeting Catherine Tate and doing the filming with her. It was a complete trip, and I loved it, and it was one of the best experiences. Going up to London, and she's like, Catherine needs someone with Tourette syndrome. And I was like, oh, I could do that. So I went in there, and there was another guy there with Tourette syndrome in the audition, and he was like, I said, hi, how are you? And he was like, I'm all right. Can I sing to your dad? And I'm like, nice to meet you too, mate. Yeah, lovely. Anyway, so he went in, and you know, told the camera he wanted to fist fuck her grandma or some shit like that. And then I went in there, and I was like, oh, wanker, tits, bollocks, wank. And anyway,
and then she called you in, didn't she, and said we'll have to cut that out.
I got out. What? Don't cut it out. Bollocks, I've got Tourette's. You can't cut me out.
What kind of cut you out yet? You're Pip Bennett, for God's sake. One of the Big Brother 7 and one of the best personalities on television. God, you've got me bad laughing now.
anyway, I got a call back for a second audition. We said that Catherine Tate wants to see you, meet you. I'm like, oh my God. I went to London and... met to see Catherine Tate and have an audition with her. And there she is, she walks in and went, hello, Pete. Right, oh, back in hell. She went, oh my God, you're off telly. And I thought, really? She was starstruck when she met me. I was like, my God, I'm a massive Catherine Tate fan. Anyway, I walked into the audition with her and, yeah, there we go. We got the script and I got her up and, yeah, went through the script. The script was literally me and her shouting obscenities at each other, which was something I'm really good at, you know. So we really bounced off each other. Yeah.
Well, she'll be in the Doctor Who specials this year, Catherine Tate, because I know David Tennant's back as the Doctor, only for a short bit, and then we've got Nishuti Gatwa taking over as the Doctor in the new year.
We need someone with Tourette's.
Actually, yes, that's right. We need a Tourette's. We need a Tourette's doctor, or we need a Tourette's companion.
Exactly. There you go.
That's the one, Pete. Oh, if you had one Christmas wish,
imagine a Dalek with Tourette's.
Aye, a Dalek with Tourette's. Who was your favourite actor?
Oh, my favourite actor's Jim. Well, it's been Jim Carrey. Since I was a kid, you know, and the reason why is because when I was a little boy and I had Tourette syndrome, you see, I didn't have anyone to look up to help me accept myself. Well, I felt very alone. Well, but I saw Jim Carrey and I thought, fuck me, look at him. He's making loads of silly faces and contorting his body all over the place.
Oh.
And I felt, and you know what, he was getting paid for it, and he was making people laugh doing it and all that sort of thing. And for me, he was the one who helped me. You know, I found him as an inspiration to accept myself. So you know, my silly faces were funny. They were, you know, and all my contorting was funny. And I also thought, you know, well, I'm going to be successful too. You know. And it was him who gave me the courage to accept myself and be who I truly am.
He has resolutions, Pete?
No.
You haven't?
I have no New Year's resolutions whatsoever. But I maybe just like, you know, don't die. How about that? Yeah, make sure I don't die this year, which is... you know, I am working on an album, so my New Year's resolution would be to
get it complete.
Make sure, yeah, to release my first single, Snail Killer, soon, and make a music video for it and release it. And yeah, that's my New Year's resolution, to make sure I get that done. But that's not really a resolution. I mean, I'm not going to give anything up, am I?
You know, no.
Because I'm perfect. I don't, you know, I'm doing all right. You know what I mean? And,
good, yeah, that's the main thing.
I might start painting, though. I might start getting my canvas out and paint. I might start painting pictures.
Oh, do you like painting as well, do you?
Yeah, because I'm a cartoonist, you know, so I thought maybe I've been really thinking about getting some paints. Yeah. I think it might be therapeutic, you know what I mean?
So how do you paint it? Do you think of something that's in your head?
Well, obviously. Oh, yeah, I just make things up. Yeah, I make things up. I used to be into Ren and Stimpy and Beavis and Butthead back in the days, you know. Like, so my artwork's very cartoony and quite surreal and terrific.
And quite relaxing.
I love to paint, yeah. Check us out on YouTube. Just write Love Dog, one word with a Z in it, and you can see some of the gigs that we've been doing. Keep an eye out for us, follow us on Facebook, and hopefully you'll like my new single, Snail Killer.
Pete Bennett, thank you so much for your time for this interview.
Hope everyone has a lovely Christmas.
Thank you very much, have a lovely Christmas yourself, and all the best for 2023.
Yeah, you too, mate. Alright, nice one, man.
Thank you, all the best.
Bye.
Bye.
He used to give me roses. I wish he could again. But that was on the outside, and things were different then. On the inside, the sun still shines, and the rain falls down. But Last night I dreamed we were together, sharing love.